Exactly 100 years ago, on the morning of June 1, 1921, the African-American district of Greenwood in Tulsa, Oklahoma, was the scene of one of America's worst race riots. And it was the first time in history that an American city was bombed from the air. Until then, Greenwood had been the most prosperous, wealthy, and well-educated African-American community in the whole of the United States. Over 10,000 citizens lived in an area of 35 city blocks and comprised nearly one-seventh of the population of all Tulsa. The area was so wealthy, it was known as Black Wall Street. Besides homes, it had bakers, butchers, grocers, department stores, 20 churches, two of its own newspapers, several schools, a library, a 700-seat movie theater, and even a hospital. The attack was launched that day by the Ku Klux Klan, which had only recently established itself in the city. By fanning the flames of racism, the organization had grown to over 3,200 members. Deeply jealous of Greenwood's wealth and success, they set themselves to the task of destroying the African-American community. Lacking a justification, they invented one, claiming a 19-year-old African-American shoeshine man named Dick Rowland had assaulted a 17-year-old elevator girl named Sarah Page. It didn't matter that she denied that it ever happened. The pro-KKK Tulsa Tribune ran an article calling for Rowland's lynching anyway. By late afternoon, a mob of KKK members had gathered at the courthouse, demanding the sheriff turn Rowland over. When he refused, a standoff ensued. Then a small group of African-American Army veterans came to help the sheriff, and someone in the KKK mob opened fire, killing two. They returned fire, shooting 10 of the KKK attackers before retreating back into Greenwood. As night fell, both sides began to prepare for the battle to come. When dawn broke on June 1st, the KKK had gathered several thousand armed men. Three blasts of a siren sounded out, and the white mob surged forward to attack. The first shot was fired by an African-American sniper who killed one of the KKK members. The rest rushed toward Greenwood and began to fire at anyone they could see. The African-Americans returned fire and for a time even appeared to be driving the mob back. The Curtis Southwest Airplane Company was based at a nearby airport and had offered to support the KKK with about a dozen war surplus aircraft. These were Curtis JN-4 Jennies, wooden fabric biplanes with two seats that the company had purchased from the U.S. Army Signal Corps after the end of World War I. What followed was the world's first firebombing of a city in history through the use of aircraft. It was not in a war with a foreign power, but rather pitted Americans against Americans in a battle along racial lines. Each of the pilots took an armed observer on board in the back seat. Some carried rifles. Others sticks of TNT. Others yet carried buckets of fabric balls that they had soaked in turpentine to light on fire and drop onto the roofs of the Greenwood district. The planes descended from above into the heart of Greenwood, focusing their attack on Standpipe Hill, a few blocks from Mount Zion Baptist Church. One of the residents, a journalist named Mary Jones Parrish, later recounted, "There was a great shadow in the sky. And upon a second look, we discerned that this cloud was caused by fast-approaching aeroplanes. It then dawned upon us that the enemy had organized in the night and was invading our district the same as the Germans invaded France and Belgium. People were seen to flee from their burning homes, some with babes in their arms. Yet seemingly, I did not leave. I walked as one in a horrible dream." Ultimately, she fled the burning city and passed by the airfield. There she saw preparations for another attack that afternoon, which she described as planes out of their sheds, all in readiness for flying, and these men with high-powered rifles getting into them. The air attack wasn't limited to bombing alone. One report tells of how a pilot steered his plane toward two men with their wives as they were running across an open field. Swooping low, they dropped a hail of lead balls or stones, hoping to kill them. They missed and the four survived, later testifying about it in court. The pilots made low passes so the observers could shoot at those on the ground. As one leaned out to take a shot, an African-American fired back. The man fell from the biplane to his death. As the Greenwood district burned, the Tulsa Fire Department responded but was held back by the white mob. When the National Guard finally arrived, the KKK opened fire on them too. Many residents fled, but fell into the hands of the mob, who murdered them. One of the town's most prosperous African-American men, a lawyer named Buck Colbert Franklin, witnessed the events and later wrote, "I could see planes circling in midair. They grew in number and hummed, darted and dipped low. I could hear something like hail falling on the top of my office building. Down East Archer, I saw the old Midway Hotel on fire, burning from its top. And then another, and another, and another building began to burn from their top." He also related that lurid flames roared and belched and licked their forked tongues into the air. Smoke ascended the sky in thick black volumes, and amid it all, the planes, now a dozen or more in number, still hummed and darted here and there with the agility of natural birds of the air. He abandoned his office and later remarked that the sidewalks were literally covered with burning turpentine balls. I knew all too well where they came from, and I knew all too well why every burning building first caught from the top. Though others have discounted the use of aircraft in the attack, the KKK itself wrote of its achievement later in their newspaper, The Nation. They said that with the use of air power, they could burn out African-American neighborhoods all across America. Later in the day, another eyewitness, Mr. W.I. Brown, reported, "We reached Tulsa about 2 o'clock. Airplanes were circling all over Greenwood. We stopped our cars north of the Katy Depot, going towards Sand Springs. The heavens were lightening up as plain as day from the many fires over the Negro section. I could see from my car window that 2 airplanes were doing most of the work. They would every few seconds drop something, and every time they did, there was a loud explosion and the sky would be filled with flying debris." Of the 10,000 African-American citizens of Greenwood, approximately 300 were killed. They were buried in mass graves. The Salvation Army reported not on the number of bodies, but that they had to feed and provide water for 37 grave diggers. Many more were injured, and the Red Cross provided tents and some basic supplies to those who had survived. The destruction was staggering. Greenwood was completely burned out. Damages totaled an estimated $23 million, which equates to about $310 million in today's money. In all, 35 city blocks were destroyed and 1,256 residences were burned to ash. 21 churches and 20 grocery stores were burned, as well as 2 banks, a hospital, the federal post office, and more than 600 businesses. Even the Mount Zion Baptist Church had burned to the ground. Only the steeple remained, towering like a symbol of hope over the burned-out ruins. Incredibly, no insurance claims were ever paid to any African American who applied. Likewise, no civil claims were ever awarded in court. Not a single person in the white mob was ever charged or jailed for either the murders or the property destruction, and nobody ever helped rebuild the neighborhoods afterwards. Hundreds of African Americans fled the city, never to return. Tulsa's African-American community, which had achieved the American dream and had built one of the most prosperous communities in the entire United States, white or black, in a single day was utterly destroyed and rendered destitute. Incredibly, the story of what happened, how it happened, and what took place afterwards was covered up for 70 years. It wasn't taught in schools, it wasn't acknowledged by the state of Oklahoma, and only in 1996 did the city of Tulsa formally acknowledge what had happened. This story has always held special meaning for me, because I'm one of the first historians who worked to bring it back to light. My part has been documenting the role of air power, and I contributed original research into the types of planes, the number that flew, who owned them, and even the names of some of the pilots. None were ever arrested, fined, or even sanctioned in any way. Their planes were not impounded. The civil aviation authorities, the governor of Oklahoma, and the mayor simply looked the other way. Perhaps the greatest irony is that the Tulsa police actually hired the Curtis Southwest Airplane Company to fly an aerial survey and document the damage done in the Greenwood District. The pilots not only got away with murder, but then got paid to document their own evil work. Today, the airport that was once called Curtis Southwest Field is closed and long gone. Nothing remains of its 2 hangars or the company. Not even a plaque marks the spot. In Greenwood, the only surviving foundation of what was once the Black Wall Street is under the Vernon AME Church. Over the years since I first published this story, I've been interviewed dozens of times by the press. As well, I've received many emails about my research. Some refuse to recognize what happened. Others claim the destruction was overstated, even if the photographs prove otherwise. Still others seek to repurpose what happened so as to feed into today's debates about race in America. For my part, I feel strongly that we should not try and rewrite this history, nor repurpose it. It's simply what it is. And this 100th anniversary gives us a chance to finally recognize the truth of what happened and reconcile with the past. As a nation, we have come a long way in understanding racism, combating it, and addressing its legacy. We have a shared responsibility not only to preserve this history, but to learn from it. The truth matters. The facts matter. And why? Because our future matters. Our future as a nation matters, not as a nation of whites, blacks, Asians, Arabs, and Hispanics, but as a nation of and for all Americans. It gave me hope when just a few days ago, on May 19th, one of the last survivors of the events of that day in Tulsa, Mr. Hughes Van Ellis, testified before the U.S. Congress. At the end of his statement, he offered, "I hope we can all work on this together." Then he held up his finger and added, "We are one. We are one." I'm Thomas Van Hare, and this is Historic Wings. If you like these videos, please subscribe, click the bell for notifications, and give me a like. Please consider sponsoring us through Patreon or through PayPal. And remember, there's always more to the story.